Should I make a blog? Do I need a blog? Is Instagram enough? So you're thinking about starting a food blog, or maybe you already have a food Instagram that's kind of evolved and you're unsure as to whether you should have a blog or not. All of those questions and more will be answered in today's video. Like, the term food blog can just mean a million different things. So first of all, the main thing to know is, where do you fit into that? Under this umbrella of the term of food blog, where are you? For me, it's food allergy blogging. So because I have lots of food allergies myself, that is my journey, my story to share. A food blog doesn't just mean recipes. I mean, for me, it's, sure, tons of recipes, but also stories about my life, product reviews, like all kinds of different things. So just because you fall into one specific niche of food blogging doesn't mean that your content should ever be limited. I started my first blog on Tumblr when I was 21 years old, and my blog has gone through many different names, many different platforms, but the thing that has remained at its core is that I'm talking about my own experiences, I'm sharing my own recipes, and I'm talking about my life with food allergies. So that's remained the constant throughout so many different iterations and changes over the years. And whether you just started sharing food content and people liked it and so you kept sharing it and now you have this following, or whether you're just debating starting it from scratch, I think the main question to ask yourself is, what is the point? Like, what is it that you want to get out of this? Do you want to share a journey? Do you want to share really delicious mouth-watering food? Do you want to air grievances about products and restaurants you don't like? Like, what is your purpose for starting this blog? There are so many social media platforms and it's hard to know where to begin. It feels like as soon as you master one platform, there's just a new one waiting around the corner. I feel like I haven't even fully understood TikTok yet, and now there's Clubhouse. The reality is that you cannot be amazing and successful at every single platform by yourself. There just aren't enough hours in the day. It's not possible. You can't form a community with every single platform. It can feel like there's always a new social media platform, and in that sense, it can feel like you're kind of always behind. Taking on every single platform at one time is a lot. It's just a lot, and it's easy to become overwhelmed, and it doesn't really allow you the time to fully engage with a community in one thing. Pick the platforms that you feel the most connected to and the ones that most reflect your style or your way of engaging with content, and just go dive right into them. Every platform works in a different way. So for me, I'm a visual person. I like to see photography, I like to see video, I like to see long form content. So I prefer blogs and Instagram and YouTube and things where I can really watch and read content. I mean, I'm gonna be honest, I haven't used my Twitter account in years. Some people prefer quick snippets like TikTok, or quick snippets of text like Twitter. You know, everyone aligns with a different type of content. Maybe you have an Instagram account and now you're wondering if you need a blog. I hear this one a lot, especially in the food allergy community, where people might start an Instagram to talk about their own food allergy journey or their kids' journey, and then there's so much community there and people are really engaged, and then you have so much more to say and you want to share all these long form stories. But Instagram's not really the platform to do that. There are a few questions that I think you should ask yourself. Firstly, how much content do you have to share? Do you just have one story that you really want to get out there? Or is this something that you can see yourself updating regularly, as in weekly or bi-weekly, or even several times a week in the long run? You should consider pitching those posts to other blogs or to e-magazines or places who have an existing audience and they're looking for new content. It doesn't mean that you necessarily have to start a whole new blog yourself, because blogs, first of all, they do kind of take a while to set up, to create an aesthetic and a vision that suits your style, and then they also have to be maintained. And if you have a blog with only one post, probably not that much traffic is going to go there after you've posted that one post. And also consider the amount of time you have available. Perhaps you really want to do a lot of updates to your blog and post content weekly or bi-weekly, but maybe right now you just don't have the time to do it. That's totally fair. So if that's the case, I would suggest considering pitching your ideas to other blogs who do have a following. Maybe they can publish them as a guest post, or pitching them to eMags, who might even want to pay you for your story and share it with their existing audience. Now, if you see yourself as a person who's like really in this for the long haul, you just love doing this, you have so much to share, you have so many experiences, you want to get them all off your chest, then start a blog. Okay, then just start the blog. I really don't think that you have to spend a lot to create great food content. It just completely depends on what you intend to do with your blog and the types of foods that you eat, and also just what's available in your region. Like, I've gone through different phases over the years where I'm spending different amounts on content. Sometimes I think realistically I probably overspent on food content. Food is everywhere, and it can be really easy to get sucked into like having to eat at this new place or having to buy this new ingredient or this new kitchen tool, and it can be really expensive. I think it's really good as a food blogger to land in a place where you're not spending too much more than you would on groceries otherwise. Now, this is obviously very different for everyone. Some people just eat dollar ramen every day, and other people are buying like lion's mane mushrooms. You know, it's a totally, there's complete different ends of the spectrum of what people spend on groceries. If you land a client who wants, you know, a specific item in their food shots, or if you have this like great artistic idea in your head and it's going to involve like maybe $100 worth of fruit or something like that, plan for that, because as someone who enjoys food photography, like those kinds of things will come up and there will be specific foods that you really want to photograph in a particular way. But you don't have to be creating these like ultra fantastical recipes all the time and spending so much money all the time. I mean, some of my most popular posts have been pancakes, loaf of bread, like egg drop soup, you know, like really, really simple things. People like simple things. You don't have to be spending so much money all the time, assuming that that's going to translate to more interaction from your community. If you're a food blogger or an allergy blogger who actually writes more long form content, or who's telling more of a personal story, which on my blog there is an element of that because I do share a lot of my insights and my musings about living with food allergy, then also have a plan for the type of graphic design that you're going to use, because you probably will have a lot of posts where food is not relevant or food photography is not relevant. And in those cases, what do you use? You need some kind of graphic to grab people's attention. Like, anytime you see an image with text on it on my Instagram, I either just created that in Photoshop, or honestly, sometimes I just create it in PowerPoint. It does not have to be complicated. But if you feel you have a small budget available to you, you can look for freelance graphic designers who can create some really stunning images. There are a lot of bloggers you'll see who have professional photographers, but it's not a necessity. I found that even photos that I've just taken on my phone can get some really high engagement. I suggest investing in a tripod. I got a Manfrotto tripod. It's really awesome, very durable, and I have an attachment for it that allows me to put my phone on it, and then I can just take really great iPhone photos with a self timer, and I don't have to hire a photography team. Personally, I'm not at that level in my blogging career or in my food photography career to actually hire someone else to photograph me, so maybe one day I'll get there, but it's good to get into a regular cadence of blogging, both so that your readers know what to expect of you and when to expect new content, but also for Google to know. Like, every platform likes some level of consistency. You know, they don't want to wonder what happened to you if you are suddenly not there on Monday and you're always there on Monday, right? Like, they want to know you're posting every Monday. Figure out a realistic cadence that works for you and stick to that cadence as much as possible. If you feel like you're just posting fluff content because you have to get it up because you always post on this day, then you're probably posting too often and you need to scale back and figure out, how often can I realistically create content that's going to be of the quality that I want to post online and share with the world. And further to that point, you need to give yourself time to actually publicize your content. You don't need to post a new thing on your blog every single day if you're a solo blogger. Like, I post things on Instagram sometimes that direct back to my blog. Sometimes I post things that just keep people on Instagram, you know? You can't also assume that everyone wants to read a new blog post every single day. It's a lot of content. People are very overwhelmed by content. So really focus in on what is the highest quality content that I can produce, and realistically, how often can I produce it in a time frame that allows me to still publicize it. When I think about the long-term planning for my content creation and my career in this field, I think about it as a long game. I mean, sure, there are people who overnight get 100,000 followers. It happens, but the likelihood of it happening is pretty low. It doesn't happen to most people. So for me, I know that I have to create a sustainable blogging game that I'm working on for years and I'm sticking around. You have to plan to not burn yourself out. And if you do catch yourself burning out, you have to stop and reanalyze and say, I gotta do something differently here. Probably all gonna find yourselves at that place at some point if you are an active blogger. I certainly found myself at that place a few years ago, and I had to stop and take a clear look at what I was doing, and I just reframed everything. I took a few weeks off. I didn't engage with anyone. I didn't post, and I just looked at, what do I want to do differently? How can I improve this? How can I put my best foot forward? And how can I create content that people are really gonna care about? And I know I'm not some million follower blogger, but I do have a very engaged community that I'm very grateful for and I'm very proud of. And it was after I made this switch, this very conscious switch, that I noticed people started to relate to me more. Is this content meaningful? People are surrounded by so much content all the time. I mean, look at myself. I'm on YouTube like way too much. If this content isn't meaningful, and if I don't think it's worth stopping in someone's scroll, stopping to read, I'd rather not post something that day. I'd rather just engage with my audience that day, engage with the community, and post something when I'm ready. Now, you've got to find your style. I know myself, and I know that I like a lot of things. And I know that when I first started blogging, I was so interested in photography. I had got a camera for my convocation gift, and I was just so eager to use it, and I practiced photography every single day for like 8 years straight. I was just in love with it. But at the same time, I did a great amount of progression, but then I kind of plateaued. And I think the reason for this is, you know, I did get into this content creation rut. It was just too much. Like, you just can't produce that much content and have it all be amazing content. I also wasn't allowing myself time to stop and research other things, other photography styles, photography techniques, to really study how to use my camera properly. I think I was just burnt out. I think I was just putting too much pressure on myself and in the wrong directions. And it felt like I was not really proud of anything that I was producing. I also started comparing myself a lot. We know comparison is the thief of joy. I would look at these bloggers who had like a million followers and I'd be like, their food photography is so much better than mine, and like, why am I not doing it as well as them? Ultimately, I needed to give myself more time to study the art of photography. I needed to learn more technical skills. I needed to experiment more with and without props. I needed to get back to the roots of what it was about photographs that I liked, because you can like a million different styles. That doesn't mean that those are all your styles. Just as I can appreciate different types of fashion, doesn't mean that I have to dress in all of those different ways. I have my own individual style. I had to do the same thing with my food photography. Fast forward to the present day, watching YouTube videos about technical skills, trying out new photography techniques, working with props, without props, with different backdrops. Those things are all like things that I'm actively incorporating into my life and that I do on a regular basis to improve my understanding of the art of photography. And as a result of that, I notice a great progression in how my photography has improved, and I feel much more confident in myself. I also came to decide on a style for myself. It took a lot of trial and error. There's a lot of photography that I've produced in the last 2 to 3 years that I just never shared because I either wasn't crazy with how it turned out, but you know what? I was happy that I tried something different. You have to try different things in order to figure out what you like and what you don't like, and not every photography style is going to be representative of you. I mean, I have some photography rules for myself that have always been important to me and that I now consider to be part of my style and aesthetic. And this doesn't, I know I'm just talking about food photography, but it doesn't just apply to food photography. This also applies to writing, figuring out what your tone's going to be, always putting your best foot forward with your writing material. And, you know, basically any type of art that you're sharing on any kind of content platform, always try different styles, different techniques, and figure out what really works best for you and best represents you as the artist, as the creator. How much to share? There's really no hard and fast answer on this one, but I think you do have to share enough about yourself to be relatable. I share a lot of things about myself, but not everything. There are some things that I just prefer to keep private, and that's up to my own discretion. I have to know when I'm crossing my own boundaries and what I'm comfortable with. Not to say your day-to-day activities or where you work or your home address. It could just be things that you like, experiences that you've had, your favorite foods, your favorite brand of pasta, the fact that you hate bucatini. Will always be a place on the internet for people who just love sharing pictures of bread. I'm a consumer of that type of content myself, but if I also know a little bit about the person who made that loaf of bread, I'm probably gonna be a little bit more interested, and it's probably going to set that account apart. And this is not to say that I just share things about myself because, like, oh, it's good for engagement. Like, these are things that I, like, truly want to share about myself and things that I really care about. I also think it's important to, like, don't get so caught up on numbers and follower count. Like, if you focus too much on that, or if you have, like, these specific goals in your head, like, I have to have, like, 500,000 followers, like, you know, you can kind of lose sight of the actual goal. Like, for me, the goal is just creating community and connecting with people and sharing my story and reading other people's stories and just, like, being, like, socially and emotionally connected within this community. Okay, next. Negative comments. I used to get comments on Twitter from people that were, like, bashing my articles, and it kind of just comes with the territory. Like, it sucks, but, like, be prepared for it. I have an alternative way of thinking about these kind of comments. That's to say that if you are only ever receiving positive comments in regards to your content, perhaps you're preaching to the choir or people who already love and accept you and, like, enjoy reading your content. If you start getting negative comments from people, it probably means that you're actually reaching an audience beyond who you normally speak to. So you're probably reaching people with completely different ideas from your own, different life situations. Maybe you have no commonalities. To me, it's kind of a sign of growth. It means that you're reaching farther. It means that you're reaching more people. So don't let the negative comments get you down. Just take it as a sign of growth. Don't take it personally. It's nothing about you as a person. It's just that someone felt compelled to make this comment on their computer, and sometimes it can be constructive comments and you might take something away from it, and other times it's just a hate comment and I just think, well, sign of growth, and that's it. Alrighty, the final topic, and one hot button topic. If I get a brand deal, they don't see me. How do I make them see me? I actually do work with brands pretty regularly, and I have some great long-standing relationships with brands, and I think there is, like, a way to go about it. There's no single right way, but there is kind of, like, a way. When I first started blogging, there actually weren't a ton of people blogging about food allergy. It was, like, kind of me and a few other people, to be honest. Like, there really weren't that many. So it wasn't too hard to get noticed, because if someone had a food allergy product, there were, like, 5 people that they could go to. I have such mixed feelings about accepting product for free. There was a point in the blogging world, like, I want to say five-ish years ago, where people were accepting so much stuff for free that it actually completely devalued the blogging world, and it became really difficult to charge for things because brands just knew, well, if you're not going to write about it, someone's going to write about it for free. So I kind of have some hard, fast rules about accepting free product because I've been there at that moment in time and I know how hard it was. And the thing is, content creation takes a lot of work. And if you have an audience that a company wants to advertise to, like, it is advertising, it is part of marketing strategy. And if a company is going out with that and they have zero budget for influencers, kind of doesn't make sense. You probably had to pay a lot to create all your content over the years and to build such an audience. So it's worth something, you know? It's not worth nothing. And I feel like now it's come back around and we value it. as a marketing or an element of a marketing strategy and something with a value attached to it. I used to feel almost obligated to accept product for free when companies would reach out to me when I was just starting out, because I thought like, oh, I don't want to miss this opportunity. And like a lot of times they'll say like, well, we can't pay you right now, but maybe we'll do a campaign in future and like we'll be able to hire you for pay then. In my experience, it has never once happened. If someone hires you for free, they pretty much just expect that they can hire people for free and they don't usually pay in the future. I've got product for free and then realized like, man, it takes a lot of time to create content and I didn't factor that into this. And now like in order to put content on my blog or my Instagram that's of high enough quality for me to actually want to attach my name to it, I have to put X number of hours into it and I have to do this much photography and this much editing and blah, blah, blah. And now I'm not getting paid for that. I do this for a living. I've put a lot of investment into my blog. And in order to create the quality of content that I am willing to stand behind, it requires a certain amount of labor and therefore I have to charge for it. If I accept a product for free, maybe because I just really like that brand, sometimes that happens. There are brands that I just love and they say, listen, we really want to send you something and there's no strings attached, then I might accept it. And then I might just like share it on a quick Instagram story. And I'm perfectly comfortable telling people that. I know it's hard for a lot of small brands, and that's why I think you just have to use your discretion. If I accept a product and I can't create a good quality piece of content with it, I'm like, is this really benefiting either of us? Like a case of free product is great and everything, but that doesn't pay the bills. A lot of companies that I work with and who I have really great relationships with pay me and give me product because they want to create this like fulsome experience so that I can create quality content and best represent their product. Other times PR companies will reach out on behalf of a product or food company or whatever and they'll say like, we want XYZ content, we really want you to be a part of this campaign, and we have a budget available. And in those cases we can negotiate a rate, and then if it's the right fit and I really like that brand and I want to represent them and I think they align with my mission, then we're off to the races. We're good and we can schedule it in and do this work together. One thing that I always do if the PR company or the food company who reached out says that they want to send me this stuff and says that they expect this content or whatever, I often just respond to them and I say like, well, I don't have any capacity for unpaid work at the moment, but do you have any budget available? And if so, I can send over my rates and then maybe we can work something out. And a lot of times, you'd be surprised, a lot of times companies do respond and they say like, yeah, okay, we really want you to work on this, so let's make it happen. It never hurts to ask. You can always ask. Any partnership that you ever take on or that you ever pitch to anyone has to align with your core values. Like, it's so important. People will know if it doesn't. Thanks for sticking around till the end of the video, and I hope that you learned something about food blogging that you didn't already know. I mean, my God, I've been blogging for so many years now, and I would hate to think that I have nothing to share with you guys, so I hope it was helpful. Bye!